The last class of my old professor's life met once a week in his house by a window in the study where he could watch a small hibiscus plant shed its leaves. The subject of the class was the meaning of life. It was taught from experience. There was no required reading, but many topics were covered. Love, work, aging, family, community, forgiveness, and death. The class met on Tuesdays and had only one student. I was that student. This is Professor Morrie Schwartz. This is Morrie Schwartz dancing. Morrie is dancing the tango. Morrie dancing the foxtrot. There's kind of a fiddler on the roof thing going on. This, I don't know what this is. Go to this church in Harvard Square every week for something called Dance Free, which he took very literally. He'd grab a partner or dance by himself. He didn't care. He could have danced forever.
Hey! Where you going?
Spring, 1979. A hot, sticky Sunday afternoon in Waltham, Massachusetts. I am wearing a blue gown and mortarboard, having just been graduated from Brandeis University.
You thought you could get out of here without saying goodbye?
Morrie is my sociology professor, my favorite professor. In my 4 years of college, I have taken every class he taught.
This is true. I remember he was the youngest person in my class.
But I compensated.
Yeah. He'd wear these old gray sweatshirts.
Yeah.
And drive around campus in an old beat-up Mercury Cougar.
Yeah.
With the windows down and the music up. Come on now. What else did you do? Come on, tell us.
I walked around everywhere with a cigarette in my mouth.
Unlit. He doesn't smoke. Such a tough guy.
The truth is, I almost never got to know Morrie. That first day I come into class, it's an intro course. I plan on hiding in the background. There are only 9 students in the room. Way too intimate. If I cut class, they'll know that I'm not there.
Hey, you! The gray sweatshirt and the 3-month-old cigarette in your mouth?
Me?
Where are you going?
To the registrar's office.
He was going to drop the class.
I was.
Al Mitchell. Is that you?
Yeah. Here.
Well, I have a question for you. Do you prefer Mitch or Mitchell?
Well, Mitch is what my friends call me.
Mitch it is, then. And Mitch, I hope one day you'll think of me as your friend.
So there was, like, no chance of dropping the course.
No.
After that first class, I enrolled in another and another.
And another. He'd hang around my office for lunch and dinner.
It's an unbelievable thing to watch Morrie eat. It's not that he lacks manners. It's just that he likes to talk while he's eating.
But I get so excited about what I'm talking about.
You forget to chew. Unfortunately, he likes eating egg salad. Oh. I'd sit across from him and have to dodge these little yellow projectiles. All the time I know him, I have 2 overwhelming urges. To hug him and to give him a napkin.
Hug me! Oh.
Do everybody else speak to Professor Schwartz? Me? I call him Coach.
I love that. Everybody should have a coach.
At Brandeis, Morrie was a bit of a campus celebrity. He taught all the big radicals, the Jerry Rubin, Angela Davis.
At first, they take my class, and then they get radical.
During Vietnam, the word came down from the administration that any student who wasn't passing with at least a C average could lose his deferment and be drafted. So, Morrie calls a meeting and makes a proposal.
Give them all A's!
So I wind up majoring in sociology. Actually, what I major in is Morrie.
Mitch has a good brain.
Summit.
He's very good at writing, very good at sports. But I think his heart was really in his music. I remember one day, I went down to the basement of the music building, and he was in one of those little cubicles, you know, the kind with the egg cartons on the wall. I knocked on the door. Mitch? Mitch!
What?
Oh, hey, Coach.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Such a gift.
Yeah, yeah. What you got there?
Some books you'll need for fall semester.
Identity, Youth in Crisis, I and Thou, The Divided Self.
Any man who plays jazz should know about angst.
Oh, I know angst.
What are you talking about? You know about angst.
My parents and I were on the phone 3 hours last night about my interest in music. Never mind.
Well, come on, you can tell me. I don't give advice.
They want me to be a lawyer.
Don't do it.
I thought you said you weren't going to give advice.
Lawyers are the exception.
Yeah, well,
they prefer lawyers to starving musicians.
But if they didn't want you to go into music, what'd they get you started in it for?
Well, they didn't. My uncle did. My uncle Mike. At least, he doesn't want me to be a lawyer. He likes music. Well, he taught me the piano, taught me football, taught me how to drive. I was born on his birthday, so my parents let him name me. If I ever do grow up, he's the person I'd like to be.
Look, your uncle may be your mentor, but your parents are your parents. So now look, now this is what you do. When you talk to them, be polite. Be respectful, listen to their good advice, and then practice, practice, practice. It's hard to find your way in life. The accidental journeys, the unexpected questions. We can't always do it alone. We have to have teachers. I and thou.
Coach, I got your present. A briefcase. MS. Oh. Your initials.
I got that. Mitch, you're one of the good ones.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to tell you something. Verhallisch Dialekt unter Erschorten.
Morrie, I don't speak Yiddish.
You're a good student. Look it up.
Coach, look,
You gotta go.
I gotta go.
You gotta go. You gotta go.
I don't know how to say goodbye.
But this is how we say goodbye. Extra credit? You'll stay in touch, right?
Of course.
Promise me?
I promise.
Say it in a sentence.
What?
Say, Morrie, I promise to stay in touch.
Morrie, I promise to stay in touch.
Now say it again so you won't forget.
Morrie, I promise to stay in touch. I didn't. I proceeded to break that promise every day, every week, and every month for 16 years. What happened? Life happened. After college, I moved to New York in an apartment building where my Uncle Mike and his family lived. And I started my career as a jazz pianist. I wasn't an instant star, but I was young, plenty of time, knock on a few doors, play a few piano bars. Go home and tell Mike about my adventures. Don't give up, he said. You'll make it. We played duets together. It was a fun time. And then Mike got sick. Pancreatic cancer. Very painful. No cure. Mike was young. He had a family. He was bitter. He couldn't handle it, and I couldn't handle it either. I tried not to look when he doubled over or threw up from the chemo. He was my hero. I didn't want to see him sick and weak. So I'd leave the room and sit at the piano by myself. And when he was in pain, which was all the time, he'd cry out. I didn't know what to do, so I just sat there and played. I just kept playing. And as the cancer spread into his stomach and his bones and his skin turned yellow and his hair fell out, he'd cry out louder and I'd play louder, and the doctors couldn't help and his family couldn't help and I couldn't help. I stopped playing music. Mike was dead. He was 42. I was 21, half his age. I thought, well, I've got 21 years left. It was time to get serious. So, I sold my keyboard, went back to school, Columbia this time, master's degree in journalism. I got a job as a sports reporter. I worked hard, I hustled, and things caught on. And then they more than caught on. I was going to the Super Bowl, the World Series, the Olympics. I got a column and a bigger paycheck. And then a radio gig, and a TV gig, and a new house, and an even bigger paycheck. And one day I woke up and said, this was meant to be. I was hatched out of the egg just like this. Whenever I got music magazines, mail from Brandeis, I threw it away. The past was the past, forget it. And so I forgot my teacher. I might not have spoken or seen or heard from Morrie Schwartz ever again had I not been surfing TV late one night, when something caught my ear. Good evening, I'm Ted Koppel, and this is Nightline. Just who is Morrie Schwartz? And why, by the end of the evening, are so many of you going to care about him?
It started with little things. Long walks would leave me out of breath, exhausted. And then I began to stumble. And then one night on the dance floor, I fell. Now, I never fall when I'm dancing. So, I had tests. Lots of tests. And finally, my wife, Charlotte, and I, we went to see this neurologist. The doctor says,
Mr. Schwartz, please, sit down.
Good news, they let you stand. Bad news.
Mr. Schwartz, you have amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, ALS, a degenerative disease of the nervous system, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease.
Lou Gehrig's disease? But that's fatal.
Yes, it is.
Well, I mean, it used to be. There's a cure now, right?
No, there isn't.
Well, how many years do I have left?
It's not a matter of years.
Charlotte and me went outside. It was a beautiful day. The sun was shining, the sky was blue, children were laughing and singing. I wanted it all to stop. I screamed, make the sun die! Make the sky black. No more singing. No more laughter. I'm sick. And I'm going to die. But the sun stayed up there. The children kept laughing and singing. The world didn't change because the world doesn't cater to me. So I ask myself, am I going to withdraw from the world like so many people do? Or am I going to live? I decided that I am going to live for as long as I have left.
Student of yours at Brandeis? In the 70s?
Mitchell Albom.
Yeah, I was a sociology major.
Why didn't you call me coach?
The next Tuesday I'm on a plane to Boston. I rent a car, I'm driving to Morrie's house. The radio's on, all news station. I'm trying to see the numbers on the mailboxes. I got a cup of coffee in one hand, a cell phone between my ear and shoulder. Listen, don't worry. I did the column last night. I recorded the radio gig this morning. My return flight's in 2 hours. I'll be back in time for the TV spot at 11. When have I ever missed a gig? I'm doing a good deed today. Yeah, occasionally I do good deeds. It's a quick sit call. Get into what I gotta do and get out. I look up and I glimpse a figure. An old man under a Japanese maple. I know deep down I should drop the phone, run to Morrie, and give him a hug. But I don't. I got work to finish. So I slide off the seat like I'm looking for something. No. Listen.
Mitch, what are you doing on the floor?
I was looking for my car keys.
Well, your car's running.
I have the car keys.
Well, how many cars you got?
Well, this is a rental.
Oh, I'm teasing you. Come on, then, let's go inside. Mitch out. My old friend has come back. You'll stay for lunch, right?
Well, I don't have a lot of time,
well,
so...
You gotta eat. Oh, you and me, we always eat. Besides, we're very healthy here. Eggplant, hummus, tabbouleh. It's like we live at the co-op. Would you like iced tea?
Oh, iced tea's good. This in here?
That's my urine beaker. You want to hold it for me? That's okay. I have helpers. Lots of helpers. And there's a woman here now, Connie. Oh, she's Italian. Oh, she's terrific. Oh, they're all terrific. I have someone to massage my muscles so they don't seize up. And someone to extend my joints so they don't crunch down. Not to mention all the help I'm gonna need when this thing really kicks in. I read that.
I can imagine.
Can you? Do you know what the worst indignity about all this is?
What?
Pretty soon someone's gonna have to wipe my ass. Set off a smoke alarm?
Actually, let me just take this real quick. Yeah. No, I didn't cut you off. I dropped my keys. I dropped. Skip it. No. Keep the interview scheduled for 11. Don't give it to Sagal. I'll be there, I promise. Sorry.
No, it's okay. My phone rings all the time now. I get a lot of calls since doing the show.
Nightline. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was something. I mean, there I am flipping channels, and all of a sudden, bom, 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 bom. I didn't know you were, you did great on the show. How'd that happen?
Well, I'll tell you. This thing I had been coming on a long time. ALS.
Lou Gehrig's disease.
Yeah. Would you get the tea?
Sure. You remember the line?
What line?
From the movie. Gary Cooper is Lou Gehrig, and he's got Lou Gehrig's disease. And he goes in front of Yankee Stadium and says into the loudspeaker, "Today, I consider myself still the luckiest man on the face of the earth."
Yeah? Well, I didn't say that. Anyway, this thing I have, ALS, has been coming on a long time. And I had to stop swimming, and I had to stop driving, and I had to stop teaching. Now that hurt. If I can't teach, what am I here for? Anyway, I started jotting things down, taking an inventory of all my decline and so on. Well, anyway, I started writing these things down, and a friend of mine sent them to a reporter. And the next thing I know, I get a phone call from Fred.
Fred?
I'm always calling him Fred. Ted Koppel. Anyway, he came to the house, and he asked me, "What did I think about his show?" I said, "Well, I've only seen it twice." "Twice," he says. He said, "Well, don't feel bad. I've only seen Oprah once."
What did you think of his show the two times you saw it?
I thought he was a narcissist.
Good thing you didn't tell him that.
No, I did. I told him. He thinks he knows the answers to all the questions before he asks them. And I said to him, "Now look, you don't know anything about dying. I do. So, if you're going to interview me, you better be prepared to learn something. Besides, he has very serious hair." Anyway, we did the interview, and already something good has come out of it.
Because you're famous.
No, because you're here.
Oh, yeah. Hey, Morrie, I'm sorry I never... I've lost touch with pretty much everyone from college. The old beer-drinking buddies. The first woman I ever woke up with in the morning.
Oh, that was in college, huh?
Well, yeah.
Well, now come on now. Sit down and let's catch up. What have you been up to for the last 16 years?
When I left Boston, I was going to be a jazz musician.
A jazz musician? I love that.
Yeah, well, I'm not a jazz musician.
Oh. Well, what are you then?
I'm a journalist.
Hmm. Well, what do you cover? Education? Science?
No.
International affairs?
Does soccer count? No, I'm a sports reporter, a columnist, actually. I also write books, do some radio, TV.
Ever been on Nightline?
No.
Oh, well.
I live in Detroit, Michigan. Motor City. Ever been there?
I don't think so.
I've been there a long time now. You'll be happy to know I'm more efficient than I was in college.
Why will that make me happy?
Well, you know how kids in college slough off.
When else are they going to slough off? When they're airline pilots or brain surgeons? Slough off when you can, for as long as you can. Enjoy it.
Oh, well, it's hard to enjoy it sometimes. Life, I mean. Work, mortgage, the pace in the city, the house in the suburbs.
Do you still drive that Mercury Cougar?
No, I don't have the Cougar. Huh. I do have cars, though.
I know. You have car keys. So, a house, the suburbs, various cars. Have you found someone to share this life with?
Share the... Oh, yes, I have. Very nice woman.
Have you named her?
Okay. Janine. She's a saint.
Oh, Janine.
Yeah. She's great. We're getting married next month. We've been dating for 7 years.
Miss Corinne Paulson.
It's hard to find the time. I mean, there's the hockey playoffs and the basketball playoffs, and then I'm into all these TV, radio, print. So you have to hustle to make sure that you're on top.
Mitch, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Are you at peace with yourself?
What is this?
I'll ask again. Are you at peace with yourself? Are you trying to be as human as you can be?
Well, sometimes I don't.
Mitch, why are you here?
Well, I saw you on the show.
You want to know what it's like to die?
No, I'm not some ghoul.
Well, that's why most people come. You see, I'm not quite alive, and I'm not quite dead. I'm somewhere in between. I'm about to take that last great journey into the unknown. People want to know what to pack. Want to know how I'm going to die?
How?
I'll suffocate. You see, with healthy people, the brain sends a signal to the muscle. The brain says, move foot. So, the foot moves. But with ALS, the signal never gets through. The muscles wither and die. Me, I've had, well, first, what happens is, first the feet, and then the legs, and then the arms, and then the hands. The body kills itself. I've had asthma for years. So, when disease hits my lungs, here's a test. Six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18.
All right. Morrie. Should I go get, what's her name?
All right. Just give me a minute. When the doctor first asked me to do that, I could reach 33. Now it's 18. My tank's almost empty.
Coach?
I'm still here. I'm still your coach.
Oh, look, I better be going. My flight. I gotta take the car back to rental place, check in. And...
Mitch! Extra credit?
What?
Never mind.
Take care, Morrie.
Mitch! Dying is only one thing to be sad about. Living unhappily is something else.
Used to be close. Pay my respects before he dies. I did my duty. In the weeks that followed, I was on the road a lot, covering baseball, basketball, the derby, and I got married. Small ceremony down in the islands. Quick honeymoon, I promised Janine a longer one, and then I was back at work. I was in London covering Wimbledon, and I remember thinking the only sport Morrie ever liked was tennis. He liked the gentility of the game. It wasn't the game I was in. I was screaming questions at tennis stars, fighting the paparazzi, chasing after players' wives for quotes.
Mitch, can I ask you a question?
The last thing I needed was a nagging voice in my head.
Are you at peace with yourself?
Peace? Sure. I write 3 pieces a day. You don't file by deadline, there's a blank page. You blow the satellite TV window, there's white noise.
What have you been up to for the last 16 years?
I'm up to my neck here. Can you give me a second? Why should I apologize? I am very good at what I do. I like it. It's a rush. I don't need a life therapist. Yeah. 1 minute piece and a 10-second tease. Got it.
Hey, why are you here?
I'm here on assignment. I'm not some college student. I'm working the press room, sending stories back to the States. I was doing TV pieces, radio reports. I was getting paid by 5 different employers. I was slamming it. Yeah.
Do you want to know what it's like to die?
No, I faxed that yesterday. Well, check. No, you check. I've got 4 interviews to do tonight.
Are you trying to be as human as you can be?
What? Yeah. No. Who am I talking to? I was 37 and healthy. He was 78 and dying.
Oh, 2 visits in 16 years. What do I hold the honor?
I was just passing through.
Through West Newton, Massachusetts?
So,
now what have you been up to since last you came?
Oh, lots of stuff. Work, travel, and I got married.
Well, now that is an excuse. Why'd you say so in the first place?
I don't know. I wanted to build the suspense.
Please, at this stage, let's skip the suspense. So, Janine, your wife, whom you are going to bring to visit soon, does she know about me?
Oh, yeah, I told her. So, your turn. What's new with you since last I came?
Well, I had my funeral last week.
Your what?
Do you remember of Zola? In the sociology department?
Yeah.
He died.
Oh.
Right after Christmas. His funeral was so sad.
Well, it is a funeral.
All these people say all these wonderful things about him, and never got to hear any of it. So I decided that's not for me. Somebody has something nice to say about me, I want to hear it right now. So I made some calls and set a date, and we had a living funeral.
You're kidding.
Oh, no, you should try it. You know, I never liked going to funerals, and now I know why. You gotta run them yourself. Well, it was very successful. Everybody came and paid tribute to me, and I thought, boy, Morrie would have liked this. And I did.
Gee, I'm sorry I missed it.
It's all right. You can come to the next one. You remember that I told you that pretty soon somebody was going to have to wipe my ass?
Yeah.
Well, I think that day's coming.
Oh! Is that day today, Morrie?
Well, don't get your hopes up. All this dependency. People carry me and bathe me and putting me to bed. Still, I shouldn't complain. I'm finding some good in it. I get to be a baby again.
That's good.
But it's not only good, it's natural. Mitch, when you're an infant coming into the world, you want to be held and comforted and caressed. Well, it's the same when you're leaving the world. The mystery is, between the coming and the going, we pretend like we don't need it. Mitch, can you help me?
Well, what's the matter?
Just shift me, can you?
Shall I get Connie?
No, you can do it.
I don't want to hurt you.
Well, I don't want you to hurt me either, please.
Okay.
Just shift me a little to the left. Put your hands under my armpits and your arms and your hands. Get a good grip around my chest.
Oh, like this?
Yeah, and then just shift me an inch or two to the left.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, it's like we're wrestling.
Well, I promise you, you'll win. So, I'm going three now. One, two, three.
Ah! Oh, I got you. I didn't hurt you, did I? I didn't mean to.
Oh, no, I'm all right. You did good.
Oh, I brought you something I think you'll like from that co-op place.
Oh?
Chicken, corn relish, chickpeas, and... ta-da! Egg salad.
Egg salad? Just like old times.
Yeah.
I love egg salad.
Yeah, I'll just stand over here.
Oh. In the kitchen. I'll eat it later.
Sure.
Don't mind me. I cry all the time. Is that a problem for you, men crying?
Oh, no. No, I'm all for it.
Mitch, I'm going to loosen you up.
Yeah.
One of these days, I'm going to teach you how great it is to cry.
Why should I cry? I got nothing to complain about. I mean, I can see crying if you're in pain or have regrets.
Well, you only cry if you have regrets. If you've lived your life the wrong way. Chasing after the wrong things. Some tears are healthy.
Yeah, well, maybe for poets and philosophers and professors. You can let it all out. You're supposed to let it all out. But what about the rest of us? If the rest of us were always crying and expressing ourselves, nothing would get done in this world. You only feel the way you do about life because you're
dying.
I wasn't going to say that.
What, dying?
Stop saying that.
But it's not a dirty word. I am dying. And I can live with that. I've got news for you too, Mitch, my friend. You're dying too. Just a lot slower.
I think about my own death sometimes.
Go on.
I have this vision of myself at the office, and I'm banging out my column, and suddenly I keel over at my desk. The editor comes running in, snatches the column from my fingers, gives it to someone else, and he starts typing. The last thing I see is a body bag being zipped up in front of my face. Boom, gone. You know how they say when you die, you see your life flash in front of you?
Yeah.
I don't see anything.
Have you told anyone about this? Janine?
I'm telling you.
So you are. This is Tuesday.
Yeah.
Tuesday was always our day. Classes on Tuesday. Office hours on Tuesday.
We're Tuesday people.
Tuesday people. So, you'll come again next Tuesday?
Yeah.
I will.
What? Come back and visit you next Tuesday.
You will? Well, that's great. Great. How about coming every Tuesday?
Every Tuesday. Well... sure.
You can do that?
Yes.
Well, what would we do?
Well, I could ask you questions, and you could answer them.
Oh, you know my weakness. For how long would you come every Tuesday?
Until the end.
Mitch, now I'm sick. You may not be so good with sick people. I mean, all the pills, the laxatives, bedpans, smells. It's not going to get any better. It's just going to get worse.
I'll see you next Tuesday.
And bring a list.
A list?
Of all the questions you want to ask. If I'm going to be your teacher, you're going to be my student. So be a good one. You got a week.
Why did I do that? Why did he let me in? Of all the students he's known, there were others who'd been better to him, who'd actually kept in touch. Why me? Anyhow, there I was the next Tuesday with some food and some homework, and...
tape recorder.
I want to record us talking so I can listen to it later.
When I'm dead.
No.
No?
Well, yes. We don't have to do it if it makes you uncomfortable.
Well, it doesn't make me uncomfortable. It's just that it's so small.
What?
Your tape recorder. Fred Couples was a lot larger. You're asking a teacher who's been lecturing his whole life if it's okay to record his voice? Oh, come on. Hook me up. Plug me in. Watch me go. Is it ready now? Is it running? Can I talk into it now?
Sure.
Everybody knows they're going to die, but nobody wants to believe it.
Jeez, whatever happened to testing? 1, 2, 3.
Why be predictable? What's your first question?
About death.
See? I'm saving your tape.
So, How can one be prepared to die?
Do what the Buddhists do. Every day, you have a little bird sit on your shoulder that asks, is today the day? Am I ready? Am I the person I want to be?
So you're into Buddhism now? I thought you were an agnostic.
I used to be agnostic, but now I'm not so sure. The truth is, once you learn how to die, you learn how to live. I wish that I had been more aware of death every day of my life.
What do you mean?
Get that book for me, Sir Redwood.
Auden, you gonna read me some poetry?
Auden, I can recite from memory. We must love one another or die.
There's a telegram inside.
It's very old. Don't tear it. Read.
Dear Mr. Schwartz, we regret to inform... We regret to inform you of the death of your wife, Bessa.
My mother died when I was very young. She'd been sick a long time. Went to the hospital. One morning, my father got my brother and me up for breakfast. Just as we sat down, this telegram came. My father couldn't read English, so I translated it for him into Yiddish. Mehubin Rachmonis, su dir moidya sein began, die niftoyes fun dein bei besser. Death. What did I know about death? I was 8 years old. I wanted my mother back. I wanted to hold me and comfort me, caress me. I wanted her to sing the songs to me she used to sing. And after my father remarried, he forbid any mention of her. So, every morning, I would go to synagogue and say a little prayer for my mother. It's the only way I had to keep her memory alive.
Don't you have any pictures of her or any letters?
The only evidence I have that my mother ever lived is this telegram announcing her death. If I had only been more aware.
Morrie, what is it?
Never mind. I think we should stop now.
We can pick up next time. If I start for the airport now, I won't be running to the gate.
Extra credit? You think I'm being touchy-feely, don't you? What is it you hate about touchy-feely?
Well, the touching and the feeling.
Mitch, would you put on the record player before you go?
The record? See you next Tuesday.
Is it today, little bird? Is it today?
Some food, come out to Morrie's. I've got a larger tape recorder. 3 times as large as Ted Collins. I checked. Morrie can't write anymore. That's tough because ever since the Koppel shows, he's done a second one now, Morrie has become a pen pal to thousands of people. I am one of his secretaries.
And finally, let me say that your letter moved me very much. Grieving has been good for me, and I hope it has been good for you also.
I hope it has been good for you also?
What's the matter with that?
It's a little jaunty, isn't it? How about, I hope you find the healing in grieving?
That's good. You're a good editor.
Thank you, Morrie.
Put that in. Thank you, comma, Morrie. Next.
This one's from a former student. Story of her life since she left the university.
A whole life?
All 22 pages.
Read.
An hour later. Hey. How do you want to respond?
Oh. Well, how about thanks for your long letter?
Thanks for your
long letter. He spends hours answering these things, no matter who they come from.
I just want to make them feel better.
You want to make them feel better? Jeez, Morrie, if anyone has finally earned the right to say, let's not talk about your problems, let's talk about mine, I mean, you've hit the mother load of sympathy here. Take advantage.
Why would I want to do that? Taking makes me feel like I'm dying. Giving makes me feel like I'm living. Oh, would you write that down?
Sure.
Oh, and put the food in the kitchen. I'll eat it later.
You got it. What's that?
Oh, Charlotte and I were making a list of epitaphs of what I want to put on my tombstone.
Kind of premature, don't you think?
I don't know. I know professors who've been working on their epitaphs since grade school. These are all quotes from poets and writers. I can't make up my mind.
Let's see. How about, I never owned a network?
Huh?
An article I was reading on the plane. Ted Turner, he was trying to buy CBS and the deal fell through. He said, I don't want my tombstone to read, I never owned a network.
The man's brainwashed. He doesn't need a network. He needs a hug. A network can't hug you. Oh, that's the trouble with this culture. More things is good. More money is good. More is good. Oh. That's why I tell my students, if you don't like the culture, make your own. Skip the shopping mall. Invite your friends over. Exchange ideas. Like the discussion group I formed, how to deal with the nuclear threat.
Who was in that?
Me, Charlotte, the guy down the street.
Did you solve the nuclear threat?
No. But we talked. We had coffee. We made each other feel better. We gave of ourselves. And no money changed hands.
Do you have something against people who have money?
Just too much money.
You know, I don't do so badly myself.
I know. But, Mitch, some of the most miserable people who come to visit me are the ones with the most money. Now, look at this room. Now, everything here is just as it was in the 1950s. We bought that television set to watch Adlai Stevenson get beat the first time. The only things new here are you and my wheelchair. But this room is so changed now. It's so filled up with love and warmth and honesty and tears. But this is a wealthy home.
Yes, it is. Oh, excuse me. Probably someone offering me some money. Yeah. No, I told you I can't do the interview Tuesday. Tuesday's out. I can do it Wednesday. Tuesday's the only day he's available? He's a diver. How busy can he be? All right, fine. Yeah, fine. Give it to Sagal.
What's the matter?
Interview I was supposed to do.
Was it an important interview?
Sort of, but...
It was on Tuesday.
No big deal. They're going to get this other writer, a second stringer.
You're angry.
No, I'm not! Okay, so I am.
Do you know why that is?
Should I lie down on the couch now? It's just that I'm the guy that always says yes. That's how I got to where I am.
Well, do you have to keep doing this? Saying yes?
Well, if I don't, they might stop asking. This guy they're sending in is a comer. He's smart, he's sharp, and he's like 10 years younger than me. Well, even the athletes I cover are 10 years younger. More, every season there's this new crop of them. Aliens emerging from their pods, eternally young.
Just like college.
What?
You were once the youngest person in the room.
Yeah, well, not anymore. There is nothing sadder in this world than a wrinkled old sports writer begging a naked 19-year-old to answer a question.
Why is he naked?
Skip it. Morrie? The world today is for the young.
I teach young people. I know how miserable they are. Their grades, their parents, their love affairs. Everything is a setback. All this emphasis on you, I don't buy it.
Then why do people say, I wish I was 20 again, not, I wish I was 65?
Age is not just decay, you know. As you age, you grow. As you grow, you learn. A tree's leaves are the most colorful just before it dies. If you keep battling against growing old, you're always going to be unhappy because you're going to grow old anyway.
Are you telling me you don't envy youth?
No, I don't.
You don't envy my youth?
Age is not a competition. Inside, I'm every age that I ever was. I can be a child. It is appropriate to be a child.
And I can be a wise old man when it's appropriate to be a wise old man.
Why should I envy where you are? I've already been where you are. It's you who should envy me. I've got 40 years on you. You know, at my 70th birthday party, my friend said, "Morrie, you're getting old." I took it as a compliment.
And so the summer goes. My collection of tapes is getting taller. My visits are growing longer. And my list of questions is getting shorter. Tuesday of the summer. This is official. The air conditioning is out at the airport. Everybody wants to kill each other. It was like getting out of Saigon, and then my plane out was laid on the ground, but of course they don't tell you that until you're on the plane, and then there's nowhere to go but sit on the runway where I'm trapped with one of the two largest, most perspiring people in America. So I've got like 5 minutes to... What happened?
I was playing hockey. I saw one of your TV shows over the weekend.
You did? Huh? So, what'd you think? And don't say I was a narcissist.
No.
Good.
Worse. You were mean-spirited. The things you said about that basketball player that missed a practice? Words hurt, Mitch.
Oh, sticks, stones. You couldn't hurt these guys with a baseball bat. It's TV, Morrie. It's a show. You didn't like Ted Koppel either, remember?
Well, I never taught Ted.
No offense, Morrie, but that guy I hurt so much will make this year alone more than you earned in your lifetime. And he can't even get to practice?
Oh, well, maybe it was a one-time thing.
Oh, come on.
Well, maybe he forgot.
Yeah, and what if I flap my wings and... Morrie, you don't forget. I don't forget. Coach, it's a different world out there than in this room.
Well, you're the same wherever you go. All right, let's get to work.
Okay.
Did you know that my sons were here over the weekend?
Really?
Yeah. We cried for 3 days straight. It was great.
Sounds terrific. Gee, why'd they go?
That feels good.
The microphone?
The touching and the feeling. Is it running now?
Yeah.
Well, I have a subject.
Go.
When young people come to visit me, one of the questions they ask is, Morrie, should we have children? As you know, I don't give advice.
Uh-huh.
Right. But?
But what?
Well, are you and Janine going to have a family?
What are you, my mother? I see all the plus things about kids. I'm worried about feeling tied down. I mean, you give up a lot of things to be a parent.
Oh, yes, but look what you get back. There is no experience like having children. Let me tell you why my sons are so special. Charlotte and me couldn't have kids. We tried, but... So, we decided to adopt. And we were blessed with the most beautiful baby boy in the world. And then one day, Charlotte feels a little queasy. So, she goes to the doctor. She's pregnant. 9 months later, we have the other most beautiful baby boy in the world. You have to go after life and embrace it. And when you do, sometimes life will embrace you back in ways that you never imagined. Love. Love is the only rational act. Without love, we are birds with broken wings.
What do you say to the person who says he envies people who don't love?
Who is this person?
He's theoretical.
Does he look like you? Why envy someone who doesn't love?
Maybe the person who doesn't love has more freedom than the person who does. A person who does not love is free to accomplish things, free to experience the world, free of the pain when someone leaves them.
Well, I thought you sports types said no pain, no gain.
That's for runners.
Well, we're all running. We're the human race. Some of us are running so fast we don't know where we're going.
You can't say that about everyone.
I can say that about somebody in this room.
If the point in loving someone is...
There's no point in loving. Loving is the point. Why do you think people say they fall in love? Because falling is helpless.
Well, I don't want to be helpless, okay? Well, maybe we should change the subject.
What did I say?
Nothing. I just think we've talked enough about love. You need a break.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Coach. I said it was theoretical. All right. Morning. Morrie. I saw the refrigerator. It's filled with my food bags.
Oops.
You haven't been eating anything?
I haven't been able to chew for months.
Why didn't you say something?
Well, I didn't want to disappoint you. Besides, you get such a kick out of bringing it.
I only brought it because I thought you got a kick out of eating it.
Boy, this is a real old Henry story then, huh? You remember? I told you that pretty soon somebody was going to have to wipe my ass. Well, I have a confession to make. That's what's happening. Somebody's going to have to wipe my ass.
I'm sorry, Coach.
Well, I know. You wanted to be here for that.
How are you handling it?
No, I'm not. Connie is.
You sure you want to stay up?
Oh, no.
You want to go back to bed?
No. No, I have a new aphorism. When you're in bed, you're dead.
A rhyming one, no less.
Well, it helps to remember. So how is Janine?
She's good.
And when am I going to meet her?
Oh, I don't know. It's hard to coordinate, you know, singers and their schedules.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah. Always on call in case somebody needs some singing. Well, I'm pretty busy myself. I've got a very busy schedule. I had another call the other day from Nightline.
What?
Well, they want to come back for one last installment. Every time Coppo comes, I feel closer to death. He should start wearing a shroud.
I don't like them hovering around you like that.
Now. Ted said that he would come even if I couldn't do the interview. He's a good soul. Not everybody on the TV is a bad guy.
Morrie. Morrie. Coach, tell me what to do.
Hit me.
Hit you?
Hit me on the back.
Like that? Yeah. Is that too hard?
Harder.
Harder?
Harder.
Okay. Like that? There. I'm hitting you hard. Is that too hard? What? Is it too hard?
Yes. I always knew you wanted to hit me.
Yeah, well, that was for that B you gave me sophomore year.
Hold my hand. Please?
I am. Are you? I look at him sometimes, and I think about the story of Job. Job is a good man, but God makes him suffer. Gives him boils, kills his cows, takes away everything he has, his money, his house, his family, his health. All to test his faith. I asked Morrie what he thinks about that. He says,
I think God overdid it. You know what I wish?
What?
I wish I had a piano.
So you could play?
No, so you could. Remember that room that you used to play in college?
Yeah.
I used to stand outside and listen. Oh, such a gift.
Yeah, well, I don't play piano anymore.
Oh, that's a shame. You said that your uncle taught you? Your Uncle Mike?
Yeah. He died a long time ago. Cancer.
Oh, well, I'm sorry for that.
Mike had two sons. When he was bad, they'd come down to my apartment, and I'd play for them cartoon songs, a theme from the Flintstones, you know. Sometimes we'd sit in this lazy boy recliner, the three of us. And the two of them fit in there with me. That's how small they were.
Well, how did you handle it? Your uncle's dead.
I didn't. The night he died, my aunt called. She said Mike was really bad. He had to go to the emergency room, but I watched the kids. It was 3 a.m. Mike was waiting by the elevator in the hallway. He was so pale, yellow.
What did you say?
See you soon, don't worry, nothing. Elevator door closed, and I never saw him again.
You wished that you had said something meaningful to him. You wished that he had said something meaningful back. You never had your moment.
Isn't that what everyone wants when someone they love dies?
Yeah. But if you wait for the famous last words, boy, you better have great timing. Because all the wise, wonderful things you want to say at the end are the things that you should have said all your life.
That's easy for you. You say the right things every day.
Oh, you think so? You remember the first time you taped me, I said that I wished that I had been aware of death every day of my life?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You were talking about your mother.
Mm-hmm. There's more. You see, my mother didn't go to the hospital right away. She was at home. and she would sit in a window on the second floor and look out on the street. Outside, I'd be with my friends playing stickball. And she was in pain. She was in such pain. And when she was bad, she'd call out to me to go get her medicine. I would pretend like I couldn't hear her. I was afraid. I was ashamed. I didn't want to look at death. I abandoned my mother when she needed me the most. I was too young. And you were too young when your uncle died. We did what we were able to do.
And the Nightline crew came back for their final visit. Morrie roused himself for his 8 million fans. He spoke about love. He spoke about compassion and responsibility. He even spoke about God. When the interview was over, Koppel pulled Morrie aside. He threw his arm around him and said, "You done good." Morrie said, "I'm negotiating to see if I get to be one of the angels." At Brandeis, the students were already into the fall semester. For the first time in 30 years, Morrie isn't there to teach them.
Midge, what time is it?
Almost 7. Why?
Well, isn't it about time for the World Series? It's on tonight, isn't it?
How did you know that?
Oh, well, everybody knows the World Series.
Oh, yeah? Who's playing?
2 baseball teams. All right. Connie told me. What is that something you usually be at?
It's the first one I missed in 14 years.
Because you're here.
Sagal's covering for our paper.
Well, you want to watch it with me?
Now, I may not be Howard Cotel.
Yes, I want to watch it with you. Won't be the first time you've interfered with my sports career.
Oh?
You remember that basketball player who missed practice?
Yeah.
Well, I thought about what you said, so I went out to talk to him, see if he had a good reason why.
And?
He didn't. Told you so.
Has he missed again?
No.
Told you so.
Hey, I better call Janine later on. I'm going to take a later flight. Can I use your phone?
Where's your little space age thing?
I left it at home. It's an experiment. I'm trying to see if I can go cold turkey.
Well, go ahead. It's a rotary dial. It's sort of like cranking up a Model T. But I think you'll get a kick out of how we pioneers used to live.
Hey, look at that touchdown.
What?
Hi, it's me. Yeah, I'm with Morrie in his house on his rotary phone. Yeah, it's made of wood, and you have to pour kerosene in it to start it up. Look, I'm gonna have to take a later flight. Probably not until midnight.
You're gonna miss dinner.
It'll be fine. Morrie's worried I'm gonna miss dinner.
Give me the phone.
What?
Give me the phone.
Jeez.
I want to apologize for making you late.
Honey, the next voice you hear will be Morrie Schwartz.
Hi! Janine! This is Morrie! So, when are you coming to visit?
Morrie!
What? Oh. Oh, I see. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I understand. Yeah, I understand. Well, now, it's been good talking to you, too. Bye now.
Hey, hello?
She's coming next Tuesday.
When I got home, I asked Janine what made her say yes to his invitation. She said, he asked me. I did not want Janine to come. Why? Have you ever loved two people from different parts of your life, yet been afraid of them meeting? You're scared if they get together, they'll compare notes. They'll say, hey, your guy isn't my guy. They'll see you fell short. They'll know you're a fraud.
Janine! Call me Morrie.
2 seconds in the door and he was flirting. It was amazing. He waxed erudite about opera.
I love Puccini. Oh, the coffee, the dying, and the crying.
He told us the epitaph he had decided on for his tombstone.
A teacher to the last.
He even covered the afterlife.
If I get reincarnated, I want to come back as a gazelle.
He congratulated us on our marriage.
Congratulations to the groom. Best wishes to the bride. That's the way it goes, right? You say to the groom, you've done good for yourself. You say to the bride, good luck. You're needed. So, Janine, you live in Detroit, great city. I remember, I was in Detroit once, at I was attending a seminar at the Detroit Hospital, and this guy, this surgeon, says to me, Morrie, would you like to see me work? I said, okay. So, the next thing I know, I'm in the operating room with a gown on and a mask, and the doctor has laid this patient out on this table,
and he's taken out this gigantic knife. Well, I go green. And then the nurse says to me, "Would you like to remove the spleen, doctor?" I screamed, "I'm no doctor. I'm a Jewish sociologist. Get me out of here."
When were you in Detroit?
What?
You told me you hadn't been to Detroit. When were you in Detroit?
So, Janine, you're a singer.
He didn't answer. He didn't even acknowledge the question.
Would you sing for me?
Now, I have heard people ask Janine to sing for them as long as I've known her. But she's shy, so she always politely declines. In fact, I was about to decline for her when suddenly...
The very thought of you and I forget to do the little ordinary things that everyone ought to do.
Morrie closed his eyes to absorb the music. Tears rolled down his cheeks. His body was stiff as a sandbag, but he was dancing. And all the times I'd heard my wife sing, I never heard her the way Morrie did at that moment.
I see your face in every flower. The thought of you, the very thought of you, my
Monday night, Charlotte calls to tell me Morrie is not doing well.
What?
It's cold and damp. As I walk up to Morrie's house, I'm stalling.
Who?
I stop to look at the Japanese mail.
Me?
I go inside. There's a strange woman in the hallway, a hospice worker.
What?
Morrie's study is empty. For a moment, I wonder if it's too late. And then, for the first time, I enter Morrie's bedroom. Coach.
I'm still here. Will you do me a favor?
Sure.
Turn my head so I can see out the window.
Is that okay?
Yeah, thanks. Oh, please.
Fall.
So, what's on the list today?
No list.
No questions?
Just rest.
Yeah. That feels good.
Yeah. It does.
I nearly went last night.
Don't say that.
It's okay.
Don't let go too soon.
Don't hold on too long. Good?
Very good.
Sure you don't have any questions?
Nope.
Last chance.
Detroit, when were you in Detroit?
10 years ago.
I was in Detroit 10 years ago.
I know. I picked up a newspaper, and there you were. Your picture, your column, everything. Such success. I was so proud of you.
Why didn't you say anything?
I did. I went back to Brandeis and wrote you a letter. You never wrote back.
Morrie, I never got your letter.
Mitch.
I swear. I stopped opening mail from college long ago. Anything from Brandeis, I threw right into the trash.
It's okay.
Honest, Coach, I didn't know.
Stop. I forgive you. I forgave you long ago. That's what you do with people you love. Mitch, if there's anyone you're fighting with, feuding with, that you care about, let it go. Let it go. If you're 100% right, they're 100% wrong. You say you are wrong. If that will end it. Because when you get to where I am, and you will, it won't matter whether you're right or wrong. Forgive everybody, everything. I forgave you. Now, you forgive yourself.
Why should I forgive myself? Jeez, Morrie, you know what I've been doing here all this time? I've been coming here one day a week to make up for the jerk I am the other six. You know why I didn't want Janine to come?
You were keeping her to yourself.
I was keeping you to myself. Morrie, in my world, there's no difference between weekdays and weekends. Work is all week. There's no beginning, no end. They're all game days. But ever since I started coming to you, on Tuesdays, there's a form. I'm excited when I get on the plane, and sometimes when I get home, I'm sad, I'm quiet, but I'm better. When I'm here with you, it's like 16 years haven't passed. There's still time and hope. I like myself better when I'm with you. When you die, I know I'm going to lose you, and I'm afraid I'm going to lose myself too. You see, it's still all about me. I was a screw-up with Mike, and I'm a screw-up with you.
Well, I guess all that forgive stuff really sunk in.
Why'd you let me come back? all the people who want to see you, I'm not special. I forgot you, Morrie. Why'd you let me in?
The same reason I let you in 20 years ago. A hollish, kind of licht, under our shorted.
Morrie, I still don't speak Yiddish.
You never looked it up? Don't hide your light under a bushel.
What are you talking about, hide my light? I'm in the spotlight.
Not that light. This light. You've got it.
How do you know?
Because it was said about someone else when I was younger.
Who?
Me.
Yeah, Coach.
I have one last favor to ask. I've picked out a place to be buried. It's on a hill, underneath a tree, overlooking a pond. After I'm gone, I want you to come and visit.
Sure.
Well, not like most people visit. Drop a few flowers and get back in the car. I want you to come when you have some time. Bring a blanket and pack a lunch.
A lunch?
Well, you always bring food.
You never eat it.
Well, I won't eat it then either. But bring a lunch. Sit and talk to me. Tell me your problems. Tell me what's going on in the world. Make it a Tuesday. You always come on Tuesdays.
Wait, you want me to come to the cemetery, have a picnic at your tombstone, and talk to the air?
Just like we're talking now.
It won't be like we're talking now, because you won't be able to talk back.
Well, I'll make a deal with you. You talk, and I'll listen.
Coach, I don't know how to say goodbye.
This is how we say goodbye. Love you.
I love you too.
I know something else too.
What?
You always have.
had another son, I would have wanted it to be you.
I'll be back next Tuesday, and I'll expect you to be a little more alert by then. Thank you. Okay?
Okay. Made you cry.
After that, Morrie stopped breathing. Charlotte kept the funeral small, as Morrie wanted, and I flew back to Detroit. Class was over. All the way home, I kept hearing Morrie's voice. You talk, I listen. And in that little phrase, I finally figured out what Morrie knew that I didn't. If you live your life as Morrie did, with people as a priority, making memories, giving of yourself, then when you die, you're not really gone. You live on inside the hearts of everyone you ever touched. So when they visit a cemetery, or they're walking alone, or they're playing the piano you taught them to play, they can hear everything you've ever given them. The next time I visited the cemetery, I brought a blanket and some food and laid out a picnic. Morrie was right. It was a lovely spot. You talk, I'll listen. I tried doing that, and to my surprise, the conversation felt almost natural. I realized why. It was Tuesday.
The very thought of you